her undergraduate degree in animal science at the California Polytechnic State University in San Luis Obispo. She worked in Yosemite National Park during the summers as a mule packer in the backcountry during college, and from there, she moved to Columbus, Ohio, and completed her veterinary education at Ohio State. And then she completed an internship in farm animal medicine and surgery, and is currently a third-year resident in large animal internal medicine. And with that, would you please join me in welcoming Dr. Grace VanHoy. I was like, yes, it's only 7:02. This is great. Hey guys, welcome. I was in this room as a third year vet student. I sat in the very back, oftentimes sleeping in the corner, but I paid attention very well, and now I'm here. So that goes to show you, you can still fall asleep in class and be really successful in life. So I will show you guys a lot of what I do today. I'll try and make it a little bit more broad since I know how many of you are interested in doing predominantly small animal medicine when you get in. And then mixed, so a little bit of both, large and small, large only, and exotics, wildlife. Awesome. Okay, we have a pretty good spread of everything. So you'll see a little bit of small, because we actually see populated pigs here. No small animal vets want to see them. I don't blame them. They are crazy to deal with medically. They're fine pets. So we see that a lot, and I see a ton of exotics, actually, as a large animal vet. So hopefully you guys will be sparked a little bit here and there. If you have any questions along the way, just stop me, and then maybe we'll have a little bit of time at the end. I can tell you my experience with interviewing here at Ohio State, since it sounds like some of you will be going soon. So I'll try and enlighten you a little bit. So who knows what's wrong with this calf? There's something wrong, other than being really adorable. Her name was Susie Q. She came to us when she was like 2 weeks old. Anybody see anything that's wrong? Yeah, they're really wonky. I think you don't realize it because she stands so well, but these joints aren't supposed to bend together at the same time. So she actually had what we call peroneus tertius. It's a muscle that's on the inner thigh. She was born without them on both sides, so she walked so weird. I was trying to find a video of her walking, but it looked really odd. So she was really cute. And she just didn't care. She just lived her calf life and did fine. So a little bit about me. He already introduced me. Charles was nice enough. But I grew up in pretty much smack dab middle of California. Anybody from California here? That, really? Yes! That was like, that's a long shot. So I'm from the Central Valley. The Central Valley is kind of this area, and that is where all the agriculture is. So a lot of people ask me why I moved to Ohio, but Ohio is actually kind of like home for me. And then I went to Cal Poly San Luis Obispo. It's right on the Central Coast, right along here. And so it was a mix of NorCal and SoCal, and we always fight with each other, so it was a weird mix. But it was really cool because I did a ton of animal science stuff there. It's probably one of the best programs for animal science in California. We had, much like here, we were lucky enough to have our own beef unit, horse unit, chickens, pigs, everything. So I got a lot of experience there because I grew up in this little town here, like in the smack dab suburbs. So I didn't grow up with farm animals at all, but now it's what I do all day long. And then I worked in Yosemite. I'm not really sure why I don't work there anymore. That was done. But I lived like right at the base of Half Dome, and I took people into the backcountry on mules, and that was fun. I got attacked by a bear once, but I lived. And then I went to school here. This is me as a fourth-year student. When there were still prison farms in Ohio, we used to go there, and they had dairies and beef cattle operations, and we used to go trim feet at the dairies. So here's me, and whenever I go to these prison farms, they'd have to keep all the male prisoners away, and whenever they got exposed to and everyone's really uncomfortable with it. So it kind of ends up in our court. So I've had to do a lot of learning about potbellies that I don't want to do. They only have one stomach, so they're really uninteresting to me. I always tell the students that they're just underachieving with one stomach compared to all the other species I work with. So we don't see a lot of this here because most people, as most of you who are animal science majors know, most systems are all in, all out. So their veterinarians go to the places where they're raised. So we don't see a lot of production pigs. We do see a lot of 4-H pigs. And we also see a ton of pot bellies. This is Vernon, it is human. He was attacked by a guy with a tire iron, and then he got rescued and brought here on a home game day. I was so grumpy, I had to come in on emergency during a home game. And I had to remove one of his ears on the other side, and he has extensive wounds all over his body. But he was a really cool pig, and he used to spend all day making a little straw fort, and then he would crawl into the straw fort, and we couldn't see him. And we're like, oh, fish and reptile vets. So there's like maybe one or two in the country that did what I did, which is go through a large animal residency. So if any of you are interested in doing zoo and wildlife, this is potentially an untapped market because they have to call us all the time for assistance with their hoof stock and especially parasites, which is a huge problem in captive hoof stock in zoos. So we go over there. We also do orthopedic surgeries quite often with them. I've done a hernia surgery on one of the bison at the zoo, so we actually work with them pretty closely, and it's always really fun. You never know what you're going to get. We had a little tiny gazelle come in 2 months ago, and they called, and they were like, hey, we just got this gazelle, and now it broke its femur, so can you fix it? And it was another game day Saturday. I don't know what it is about game day that attracts emergencies, but they came, and it was actually pretty tame. So they had the handlers with it. His name was Spoons. I don't know. And they anesthetized it, and then Dr. Niehaus and I operated on it, and it was really fun. So if you're interested in doing zoo and wildlife, potentially think about doing large animal. And then everyone forgets, I forgot even to put another one up here. So aquaculture is getting pretty huge. If you ever want to work not very much and make all the money go into aquaculture, there's currently like 7 vets in the world that do aquaculture, and one of them is a former grad from here, and he, I think his starting salary was like $300,000, so just think about it. But we do that, and then we are also responsible now for bees. So if anyone needs any kind of antifungal or antibiotic that they need prescribed for bees, a veterinarian is now required to be involved in that process. So we're kind of jumping into this whole new world of apiary medicine. I don't even know what it's called. And they actually had to have a little workshop on it at the last Midwest Vet Conference because no one knows about it, and all these farmers are now calling these vets up like, hey, I need some tetracycline for my bees. Which is very common because they have a lot of weird diseases that they need antibiotics and antifungals for. So something weird to think about. This is us doing a pedicure on Sancho. Did you guys ever meet Sancho? He came to open house for like the last 10 years. Anyone? No? Wow. Dang. We're living in a post-Sancho. actually just euthanized the cow because she was in labor for 12 hours or so. And this is her uterus here. And this is way bigger than it should be. The calf actually had something called hydrops. So it produced way more amniotic fluid than was normal. And she couldn't actually deliver the calf because her uterus was so heavy that she couldn't have a forceful contraction. And so this is probably twice the size that it should be. It was really cool to see how big it was in relation to this student, this former student in plant. And I do a lot of teaching. I really like teaching a lot. That's part of the reason why I stayed in academia, because I really enjoyed being a vet student and I enjoy teaching vet students quite a bit. So I do a lot of that. Who's trying to find me? I'm somewhere. Oh, there I am. There's me in the academic building. This was me as a first year vet student before I knew really what was happening. And here's this guy, you know. You guys know Niehaus, right? Is he your advisor still?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know. Yeah, there's Niehaus teaching people how to sew together some bovine skin, which the students always hate because it's leather, and trying to sew leather together is very difficult. Also, I'm a camel spa technician. This is a really grumpy camel that came in, and I thought he was going to have parasites because he had a really low protein, and so I just assumed that it was parasites, and we dealt with him for a long time. And I had to bathe him so often. This is me really upset about it, and someone taking a sneak photo of me giving him a bath. He ended up actually having GI lymphoma. So I had assumed the low protein was because of parasites, but it was because his entire GI tract was lymphoma and he couldn't absorb any protein. So he actually ended up getting put down, and we found that on his autopsy. I do mostly internal medicine. I do a lot of soft tissue surgery because I'm a farm animal vet and we do both. We do medicine and surgery. But I'm actually getting boarded as an internal medicine specialist in farm animal. I have to learn equine too. It's part of our program. And anybody that's boarded in internal medicine is boarded in both farm animal and equine. And so I do a ton. This is my intern mate. She did the internship with me and she's training to be an internist at Texas A&M right now in farm animal. This was our first blood transfusion together. I'm glad I took a picture of it. Just take pictures of everything you do. I sound like a parent, but you won't realize how awesome it is to look back on. And then this was an alpaca that got bit by a snake, and I had to do an emergency trach on it, and it was my first trach, and I was terrified, but it went okay. Trachs are way easier than you think they're going to be. They are as easy as it looks in the movies. She ended up doing just fine after we put her on steroids. And we actually ordered anti-venom and gave it to her, so that was a weird case. Snake bites don't really happen that often in Ohio. And this is the world's meanest Scottish Highland cow that was having trouble standing, and we had to put her in the float tank. And she knew how to use her horns to kill people, so we covered them with various objects around the clinic. So this is a nipple from a calf bottle and a tennis ball that we found. She ended up having a fracture in her spine from another cow riding her because the other cow was in heat. So that was a weird case. And this is Toppling Ted, one of my favorite medicine cases. He had Listeria, so we recognize Listeria because it looks like one side of their face has had a stroke because it affects all the cranial nerves that come out of the brainstem. And so usually they can't swallow. They'll have a nose droop and a lip droop, and their tongue is hanging out. And they can't swallow their drool, so it looks like they have rabies because they're just drooling everywhere. And then their ears and eyes are actually drooped as well. So this is really classic. Listeria, but I liked Ted because he was a super nice steer. I'm sorry, I just can't find myself. He was like 1,000 pounds, and she called. She's like, I don't really know how to get him back to the stall. So we circled him around the barn until we got back to the stall. It was really funny. He actually ended up doing well. And I added this cool picture of a spinal tap on a bull that I did. So this bull is actually, he belongs to Select Sires, which is a company that does a lot of semen work. They're in Marysville or right outside of Marysville, and they have really, really expensive dairy bulls that they ship semen all over the world. And this guy came and he looked really neurologic, and so we actually put him under anesthesia and I did a spinal tap near his head. Normally we do spinal taps near their hips. So this was actually the first time I'd done it near the head, and it was really fun. And I look weird because my glasses are low on my face. It was really awesome. You can actually ultrasound the spot and see the spinal fluid very well. So I was pumped to do that. We don't often get to do that. Usually I do it with them standing and I go by the hips. So that was fun. And then I do a lot of surgery, which is really fun. I don't really like orthopedic surgery that much. Bones scare me, but I do really like soft tissue surgery. But this was a fun orthopedic case that I worked on. This guy, which we eventually named Tibbs, Mr. Tibbs, because he broke his tibia, the first part of his life was really difficult. He was born, his mother had a uterine prolapse, so her uterus fell out of her body, and so the veterinarian and the owner were putting it back in. They finally get the uterus back in after like an hour, and they were stitching her up, and then she accidentally bled out, because when their uterus comes out, it compresses the arteries as it falls out over the brim of their pelvis, so it hides a really bad arterial bleed until you get it back in and all the pressure's off. So she actually bled out. She fell onto Tibbs and broke his leg, his femur. So he's born, his mom dies, and while she's dying, she breaks his femur. And then they milked zombie colostrum out of her so they could give it to Mr. Tibbs and brought him straight to the hospital. So he never knew his mom. I feel really bad, but this is what we did. We put a crazy external fixator device on him, and he had it for 4 weeks. It looked just like an erector set that went through the bone in multiple spots. So here, here, and then down here as well, and had connecting rods, and it was totally Legos. And here it is. We actually covered it up with a bandage, but he did really well, and he healed very quickly. Bones in young animals heal without any difficulty at all. And he loved humans because he thought he was a human. And I do a ton of surgery on standing cattle, which is weird. Most people from the general public think that's probably the weirdest thing they've ever seen. But most of the surgeries we do on cattle are standing. So we anesthetize with lidocaine their flank, and then we go in and they're just standing there chewing their cud while we're doing it. I do a lot of obstetrical work. Tons of pigs. We do all the pig C-sections in the world, it feels like, which is really, really crazy. Their uterus is so long. You just keep pulling out uterine horn. You're like, well, I wonder when this is going to end. And then you pull out all these little piglets. First, they're under anesthesia as well, so you have to rub them, and then they get loud. When they start screaming, you know it's good. And we do a lot of small ruminant, like sheep and goat C-sections. We do those standing as well, so she's just hanging out while we're doing surgery on her. This is everyone's nightmare. This is called a schistosomus reflexum. It is actually a congenital defect that happens every once in a while, where these calves are born without any covering over their body, and usually their legs and their head are all coming out at the same like weird location. This guy was born alive, so I didn't know it looked like this, because all I was feeling when I went in the vagina was a head and some feet, and I was like, okay, this is too big to come out, we'll do a C-section. So we started doing the